Good evening. It is a great joy to be with you here, and I'm very grateful to have been invited. I'm very grateful to Vladimir, to the organizers of this conference, to the many volunteers that have worked. And all this has already been said by the other speakers, but it needs to be repeated. I'm also deeply grateful in general to the Russian people, and that also has been said by some of the presenters, for the nourishment that I received personally through Russian literature, through Russian music, through Russian art, through Russian spirituality. In our monastery, we have a great devotion to the icons. And when I saw here some of the icons that I had only seen in print, the Vladimirskaya, for instance, I was very deeply touched. And we have a deep devotion to Saint Seraphim of Sarov. I feel very much as if this were a little bit of a homecoming coming here. But I'm also in a very special way and in a serious way that even makes me sad when I think of it, deeply grateful to the Russian soldiers who liberated Vienna when I was a teenager and lived in Vienna. We were occupied by Germany, and the Russian soldiers liberated us, and you know at what a high price of life. But just mentioning war reminds us that after more than 60 years later, when we thought that a war of such dimensions and of such horrors would put an end to all war, we are still fighting wars, and that points out that our mentality, our whole consciousness, has to dramatically change. Unless we make a dramatic leap forward in our consciousness, even our chances of survival are not very good. And since many of the wars that are being fought right now, there are some racial wars, many racial wars, but there are also always so-called religious wars. In other words, wars that somehow take religion as a pretext. The idea of religious war is nonsense, because every religion wants peace or speaks about peace. But still, there are always within the religions people who make wars and take religion as a pretext. So we also have to change our whole understanding of religion, and that means that this leap forward in consciousness implies a step forward in our God image, in our understanding of what God means. And this is the topic that I have been given for tonight, a topic that we need to work on together, and a very personal topic, because about many other topics, one can talk in the third person. One can sort of look at it from the outside and analyze and rearrange things. But when it comes about our God view and about the emerging God view, it's so personal that I can only do it in the first person. And I have to invite you to really work with me. I cannot give you an input on it. I can only facilitate together that we think about these matters and together work our way into it. And since this is so serious and so personal a thing, I invite you now for a very short time, maybe just half a minute or so, to silence. If you put your feet flat on the ground, that usually helps, and put your spine in an upright position, and maybe even close your eyes if you feel comfortable, and until I clap my hands or start talking again, we will take a moment of silence just to bring ourselves to the heart, to bring our mind down from the head into the heart, and to prepare ourselves to deal personally with so big a topic. Well, we will have to talk about three questions. We will have to try and find answers to three questions. First of all, if we talk about God image and evolving God image, we have to ask ourselves, what do I personally mean by God? What do we mean by God when we say God? What do we mean? That is the first question we need to answer. After that, we will try to answer the question, how do we experience God? Because this is a matter of experience, or else it is just a second-hand knowledge, and that is not what we want. So how do we experience God? That will be our second question. And when we have come to some answer for these first two questions, we will have a third question, and that will be, what are the consequences? What are the practical consequences? So what do we mean by God? How do we experience God? And what are the practical consequences? Again, let's start to find an answer to the first question by starting with our own experience, with own personal experience. And I suggest a sentence from the writings of Saint Augustine. Saint Augustine lived in the fourth and fifth century, and had an enormous influence on Western culture in general. And he said, he was one of the earliest psychologists. He was one of the earliest people to think introspectively and to analyze his own experience. And he had this important sentence, "Restless is our heart until it rests in you, O God." That is an important sentence from St. Augustine. Restless is our heart until it rests in you, O God. And I think the first part, every human being will be able to say, yes, I know what he means. Restless is our heart. There is this restlessness within us, and we are always seeking for something. We are longing for something. We are groping for something, but we don't even know what it is. We are just looking for it. Restless is our heart. And when he says, until it rests in you, O God, we should now be very careful that we do not jump to the conclusion that he already knows what he means by God, and then says, and restless is our heart until it reaches that God. No, the whole point is, this is what tells us what we mean by God, that for which our heart is restless. And it is an open-ended quest. We do not know yet there's God, and we hear everything about God, and then we said, yes, and restless is our heart until it rests in God. No, we start only with experience. Every human being knows that our human heart is restless. This is how we are made. We are restlessly looking for something, and that rest, that search, is our search for God. Whether we use the word God or not, it's our search for the ultimate. It is the search for meaning. And meaning is a very important word in this context, because human beings can survive, we all can survive, for much longer than we think without food. we may get very hungry, but we can survive. We cannot survive very long without drink. Humans need to drink and they die of thirst very soon. But the one thing without which we cannot survive at all is lack of meaning. When something is meaningful to us, we can bear great pain, great difficulties, great hunger, great thirst. But in the moment a person loses, a patient, for instance, in the hospital, loses meaning, the meaning of life, they die. Or they are practically dead, even though their body keeps living on. What keeps us alive as human beings is this search for meaning. And what do we mean by meaning? This is also very important to clarify this term, because quite frequently, meaning is confused with purpose. And those are two very different things. Meaning is that within which the heart finds rest. That is why I called it meaning when St. Augustine said, restless is our heart. Meaning is that within which our heart finds rest. And we all experience that every so often we come to a point where something is deeply meaningful to us, and we said, ah, and we rest for a moment. But very soon we get restless again, and then we look for something else, and then it goes on, and the search goes on. But that within which we find rest, that is meaning. Now, purpose. With purpose is a very different thing. Purpose to purpose leads an activity which we call work. We work in order to achieve a particular purpose. And when this purpose is achieved, the work ends. In most cases, we cannot even continue working because once the purpose is achieved, there is the end. This is a very nice, clean stage here, very nice, clean floor. Again, many thanks to our volunteers. But I could go around and with a broom or a vacuum cleaner, try to clean this floor. And as long as there is the least little speck of dust, I can still clean it. I'm still working, I'm cleaning it up. If I keep going on and on and on, and it's already absolutely clean, somebody will come and will say, why are you playing around here? It has suddenly turned from work into play. And if I say, oh, this is very meaningful to me, I like to dance around with my vacuum cleaner, then nobody can fault me. This is play, and play has no purpose. Play has all the meaning within itself. An orchestra doesn't play in order to get somewhere. The orchestra that plays the fastest wins, or something like that. It plays to play, and you don't dance in order to get somewhere. You dance in order to dance in order to dance. So that is meaningful activity. It has all its purpose within itself, nothing outside. But the goal is not to play off purpose against meaning. The goal is to combine purpose and meaning, and that means to work meaningfully and to play constructively and creatively. That puts the two together, and work and play together is leisure. To work leisurely and to play leisurely, that is a combination of the two. That was just a little parenthesis in order to distinguish meaning from purpose. And meaning is what we are after here. Restless is our heart until it rests in you, O God, and we long for this meaning. So the answer to this question, what do we mean by God, is that it is the goal of the restless search for our heart. And once in a while, we are struck by an experience. Sometimes it's a big experience, sometimes it's a very little one. We are struck by an experience where meaning suddenly takes hold of us, because purpose you have to take hold of. You have to keep things under control in order to achieve your purpose. But meaning takes hold of you. When you, something becomes meaningful of you, it takes hold of you. And sometimes something takes hold of us and suddenly we find meaning. We can rest in that. And Abraham Maslow, and yeah, I would like to say a few words about Abraham Maslow, who together with Stan Grof was one of the founders of the transpersonal movement. Abraham Maslow, as a young psychiatrist, was very deeply impressed by some of his teachers, and so much so that he said he wants to study, he wants to find out why these were such eminent human beings. What made them so special? You see? What made them specially healthy in the sense of creative, resilient, inventive, patient, and so forth, all the great qualities of a human being. And he said, even though he had a doctorate in psychology, nothing at all had prepared him to say what makes humans healthy. He only knew what made humans sick, but he had never learned what made humans healthy. And that started this whole integral, early on, was the earliest start of his search for an integral psychology. And then he studied this for a long time, for many years, and in many countries, and with a great staff of helpers, and eventually came up with a result that highly surprised him. And the result was that all these people who were outstanding human beings had mystic experiences. And that was greatly surprising to him. And it didn't even go over very well in psychological literature, so he changed the term. At first he wrote about mystic experience, but then he changed it and he called it peak experience, because it is really a peak of our consciousness, a peak state of our consciousness, which we reach in those moments. And it's important for us now, before I go on and say more about these peak experiences, to remind yourself of one of these peak experiences that you yourself had. Because another finding of Maslow was that this is not restricted to the outstanding human beings, but that every human being has these peak experiences or mystic experiences. And that means no less than that the great mystics are not a special kind of human being, but every human being, that includes you and me, is a special kind of mystic. You are a special kind of mystic. The mystic is not a special kind of human being. All human beings are meant to be mystics. The difference between the mystics, the great mystics, the well-known mystics, or these great people that Maslow studied, and the run-of-the-mill person is that the great ones allow this mystic experience to flow into their daily life. They allow it to change their life. And many other people do not allow these mystic moments that we experience to influence our life. We suppress them, or we forget them, or whatever we do with them. So it's important for us to remember one of those moments. And the characteristic is not that it has to be a big bang, because it is called a peak. It doesn't have to be a peak in the Himalayas. A little anthill will do. It also comes to a peak, as long as it is elevated over your normal state of consciousness. And the characteristic would be that somehow you feel at peace. Somehow you can rest in it. It's a moment of meaning. Somehow you are one with all. You feel united with all in that little moment. And the cause for this effect is often so negligible. Sometimes it is a great experience. You hold your firstborn baby in your arms, and suddenly everything makes sense, meaning you can rest in it, you're one with all. But at other times, you are just riding on the metro, and you're tired, and nothing specially happens, but suddenly you feel one with all these people, and you feel like you are sister to all these people that are here on the metro. You're one with all, just for a split second. That would also be a peak experience. Or very frequently people have these experiences in nature. Whatever it is, it's not so important. What is important for us is that I have made it clear enough what we are talking about so that you can identify with it. So allow me to ask a show of hands, who feels that they have had big peak, little peak, whatever, a peak experience? Wonderful. We are together. Very good. Thank you. All right. Thank you. Now we can go on from here. Because in this peak experience, we have the essence of what spirituality is. We are still asking, what do we mean by God? And this is certainly belongs here, spirituality. We have talked about religion and spirituality. Spirituality in the sense that we are fully alive. You see, we are fully alive in those moments, more alive than at any other time. And that is the essence of spirituality on a very high level of aliveness, but not only on this highest level, often on all levels. That's optional. But at any rate, on a deep level, we are alive in the full sense, and joyfully alive, even if we are grieved and even if we have pain that is compatible with it, joyfully alive. Now, the great question is, how does one come from this moment of spirituality, which we have all experience from the mystical moment, which is the heart of every religion, because every religion says, yes, mystic is the heart of what we are all about. How does one get from there to the religions as we see them around us that seem sometimes to have very little to do with this spirituality, very little to do with mysticism, sometimes even opposed to mysticism? How do we get from the one to the other? And my one-word answer, I'll give you a longer answer afterwards, but the one-word answer is inevitably. We cannot help it. We get there. And I will show you why. And again, I'm simply appealing to your own experience. When you had your peak experience, when you have this experience of oneness with all and aliveness and joy and peace and meaning, your intellect immediately, not then, but a moment later, your intellect already says, and what was that? And wants to interpret it, and does interpret it. And we are built in such a way that we cannot help it. Our intellect is part of our consciousness and always wants to experience what happens to us. And so the intellect says, this is what it was. And that depends very much on our frame of reference. If we are Christians, the intellect will interpret the peak experience very differently than when we are Buddhists, or when we are Muslims, or when we are Native Americans, or whatever we are, shamans in Siberia. It will depend on the environment and on the frame of reference, but always the intellect will interpret it. And even if your intellect says, this cannot be interpreted, one cannot say anything about it, everything that you say about it is more false than it is true. It is too transcendent. Even that is a statement, and even that is a doctrine, and actually it is what has been called negative theology, and even in the Christian tradition it has been said all along that whatever you say about God is, no matter how true it is more false than it is true. The mystics have always known that. So whatever you do, you interpret, and this interpretation by the intellect is the beginning, is the seed of what eventually becomes doctrine. You have your own, even if it's just your private religion, you have your little, you have your doctrine. Then comes your will and your willingness, not your willfulness, but your willingness, your will, and your will says, oh, to be one with all, that is wonderful. This is how one should live. You see, I want that. That's beautiful. That's so good. Feels so good. And that is the beginning and the seed of all ethics. That belongs to it. So from the peak experience, from the mystic experience, you come not only to doctrine through the intellect, but you come to ethics through your will, your willingness. It says, yes, let's do it. And all the moral systems in the world, different as they are, sometimes look even contradictory to one another. But what they have all in common is that they say, this is how one should live when one belongs together. You see? We belong together. And formerly, that border of the people who belong together was drawn very narrowly. Primitive tribes often called only themselves the humans, and everybody else was the others, and you could treat them any way you wanted, but the humans, that was us, you treated them as one treats people with one whom one belongs together, morally right. The circle has widened and widened, and now it is no longer ethical at all to exclude anybody or anything. Not only all human must be included, but all animals, all plants, the whole cosmos, all must be included in order to make ethics really ethical, to make morals moral. So we have already two elements that belong to every religion, doctrine and morals, and now comes a third one, because your emotions also do something when you have this peak experience. And your emotions come in and celebrate. You see, this was beautiful, let's celebrate. And this is the beginning and seed of ritual. You see, ritual is the celebration of mystic union. And even your private religion, again, maybe you had a peak experience somewhere on a bench in one of those beautiful parks here in Moscow. We were sitting on this bench and suddenly had this wonderful experience of oneness with all. Well, on your way to work, you might want to make a little detour and visit this bench and just remember, oh, it was on this bench that I had this great good feeling, and every time you go by, it gives you this good feeling again. That is a little pilgrimage, so you have already ritual in your life. Or on your birthday you celebrate, or on some anniversary you celebrate what happened there in the past to you, and that is a liturgical calendar, the beginning of it. So in your own, from your own experience, you know that inevitably from the peak experience, from the mystic experience, springs all the elements that we associate with religion. But now you, time goes on and a community takes over, because religion is always a matter of community, spirituality is also a matter of community, and now the community as a whole sets limits and boxes things in and makes things harden. For instance, doctrine, which formerly just always referred you back and reminded you of the original mystic experience, becomes doctrinaire, and it has to be this way, and everybody who says it differently must be wrong. So suddenly it has become dogmatism. The same with ethics. Formerly, it was just one way of expressing how one acts when one belongs together. Now it has to be done exactly this way as it has always been done, even though the circumstances have changed completely. And that becomes now moralism, another ism. And ritual, which formerly was the celebration and spontaneous celebration of the mystic experience in whatever form it needed to be celebrated and wanted to be celebrated, suddenly becomes, you have to do it exactly in this way, and you have to hold your hands exactly in this way or in that way, and you have to bow exactly in this way, and walk exactly in this way, and suddenly it has become ritualism and is no longer ritual. It is as if the life-giving waters that gushed forth in the mystic experience suddenly freeze. I see all these beautiful fountains here in Moscow, and I imagine in winter either they shut them off or they are really ice sculptures, whatever it happens. But I see some of these religions in the world, and my own not excluded, in many ways like one of those frozen fountains. So what do you do with a frozen life-giving waters? You have to thaw it up again. You make it liquid again. How can we do that? Only with the warmth of our own heart, only with the love of our own heart. That's the only warmth that can turn frozen water, living water, spiritual water, into a life-giving water again. So religion is not simply like a train and you get on and it will get you there, but it is a gift and at the same time a task. It is the task to make it what is meant to be. It gives you much, it gives you much, it brings you much from the original inspiration, but you have to make it your own, but with your own lifeblood, with your own warmth of your own heart. The two always go together. So once we see that, once we see how we get inevitably from mystic experience to religion, we also see that finding God, what is God, is a task of the human heart, is a task of our love. And so we can ask now the question, the second question, we have answered the question about God, that is an open-ended search, and now we ask, how do we experience God? And here we could say, we could switch for a moment, I will come back to meaning when we answer the third question, but now I'll try to answer the second question, and there I would say, how do we experience God? Again, from your own experience. You know that we live in a given world. Every moment is a given moment. Your own being here is a given, as we say. It's a given fact. You have not made it, you have not earned it, you haven't paid for it, you haven't contributed to it. It's given. It's simply here, it's given. And that confronts us with a way of experience the divine through grateful living. If the whole world and everything in it is a given, and nobody can deny that, you don't have to be of this religion or that religion, this conviction, that conviction, this ethnic background or that, not every human being will have to face the fact we live in a given world. If it's a given world, then we can experience it through grateful living. And the first thing that we experience is that it comes from a totally mysterious source, which we could call the source or the giver if we want to personify it. But there it is. We find ourselves in a given world, and so there is this mysterious giver, there's this mysterious God, source. We know nothing about it, except that if we explore it, science explores it, spirituality explores it, poetry explores it, arts and music, everybody explores it, and there's more and ever more and ever more, and we come to no end. And this dimension of more and ever more, is one aspect of the giver. or the source of everything. But then out of this source comes everything there is. And of this everything there is always also more and ever more. You come to no end. The 100,000 things, the Hindu tradition calls it. There's more and ever more and ever more all around us. And all is gift. And you and I, we are all part of it. And that is also divine in the sense because you never come to an end. In that sense, divine. And that is the gift. So we experience the more and ever more, which is a term for the ultimate, it's a term for God, on the one hand as the source or giver, on the other hand as the gift. And now we can, the natural thing is to give it all back through this dynamic energy that wants to give it back. And we don't have to say thank you. When children show themselves grateful, they don't show themselves grateful by saying thank you. When you bring them a gift and they say thank you, put it down and play with something else, you will say they were very well trained, but you will not say they were very grateful. But when they play with it and play with it, never say thank you, but play with it all afternoon, you will afterwards say, they were really thankful, weren't they? So the same with us. We don't have to say thank you. We don't even have to go to, we will want to go and sing praises, but if we forget to do that, we show ourselves grateful by what we do. A mother shows herself grateful by being a mother. A flower shows itself grateful by blooming. These beautiful chrysanthemums here. A bird shows herself grateful by singing. A scientist shows himself grateful by doing science, and so forth. A musician by making music, a dancer by dancing. We show ourselves grateful by what we do, by this dynamic element of which Andrew Cohen spoke last night. He spoke about the unmanifest, the manifest, and this dynamic element. The unmanifest is the source from which everything comes. The manifest is everything there is, and the dynamics is the love and the creativity and all the energy that we put into it. And those of you who are familiar with the Christian tradition will inevitably have noticed already that what we are talking about is what in the Christian tradition you call God or the Father, we should also say Mother, Father, Mother, God, the Word, the Logos, and the Holy Spirit. And you have this beautiful Rublev icon of the Trinity that is the most beautiful image of the Trinity ever. That should come to mind in this context. What's important about it is that the moment we started out by asking how do we experience God, we have gotten to a new emerging God image. And it is always emerging. It is emerging in our time in the sense that more people than before become aware of it. But it is always emerging. You can't say, and then it will have emerged, and what then there will be here. No, it is emerging because you go on and on and on to ever new discoveries in that sense also. It's an open-ended notion of God, open-ended God view. And it is a God view in which you are totally immersed. It is no longer a God outside. We can no longer live in our time where we know that everything hangs together with everything. We can no longer live with a God that is somebody else. Thomas Merton, who has already been mentioned in one of the talks, a great Cistercian monk of the last century, said, God isn't someone else. God isn't someone else. And Buckminster Fuller, whom you, some of you know through the geodesic domes, and he was a great architect, he said, no more second-hand God. He said, no more second-hand God. We want to experience God from within. And the moment we do that, we discover that we ourselves come forth from this source, from this pregnant nothingness into existence and go back into back to God in this, what the Greek fathers called the round dance of the Trinity. The Logos comes forth from the Father and returns through the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Spirit, to the Father. And we are totally part of that. That is our life. That's what we are as humans. But for those, and now I come to the third part, to the question, what are the implications? For those of us who are not so familiar or even feel not so comfortable with the Christian view, we can go back to the question of meaning, and we will come to very similar results, because we can ask ourselves, and again I'm inviting you, what happens when something becomes meaningful to you? What happens when you experience meaning? And the first thing is, check that out against your own experience, the first thing is that there is something that has meaning. That is always necessary. Try to think of a moment in which you experienced meaning, and there was something. It was either another person that became deeply meaningful, some music that became meaningful, a tree, a flower, the starry sky, a situation, whatever it was, but something. And that something we can call word. There's always one aspect to meaning, and that is word. And word, because it speaks to us, it tells us something, it speaks to us. And under that aspect, word is inseparable from meaning. There's also a second element that is always there when we speak about meaning. And remember, we said that the search for God was the search for meaning, so we are still talking about God when we say that. But the second element is silence. Silence is necessary because unless word comes out of silence, it isn't word. It is just chatter. It's just chit-chat. Word that is really word comes out of silence. We all know that. I'm sure you have experienced the difference between meeting somebody somewhere here on the corridor, so on the stairs, and you have a quick exchange of words. That is not a dialogue. Then you sit down maybe, and you sit outside or sit down somewhere and quietly, and you exchange. But what you exchange in a dialogue that's so different from a exchange of words is really not words at all, but is the deepest silence within you that reaches out to the silence in the other person by means of word. You see, the words are then only the means, and it is exchange of silence with silence. So the real element here of meaning is the silence. So we have word and silence, something becomes meaningful, but there has to be a third, because if there's only word and only silence, there's not yet any understanding. And for it to become meaningful, you have to understand something. So understanding is a third element. It is the dynamic. The silence is like the nothing, like that fruitful womb of nothingness, of emptiness, out of which the word comes. Word is everything, and understanding ties together the word and the silence, ties them together, because understanding is a process, and it happens when you so deeply listen to a word that it takes you where it comes from. Do you understand what I mean by that? You listen so deeply to a word that it takes you where it comes from, and that is the silence. And when you go there, when you allow it to lead you and to take you, then you understand. So it's a process, that process. And these three together are elements of finding meaning. And we could say they are elements of finding God. And remember always, God not as, now you have found God, that's it. But when you find God, you have caught a glimpse, and it's incredibly wonderful, but then it goes on and on and on. There's no end to it, because that's exactly what we mean by God, the more and ever more. But wherever you find it, there is word, silence, and understanding. And now we find, and that is a tremendous surprise, well, shouldn't really be a surprise, but it came to me as a great surprise over the years as I was engaged in interreligious dialogue, that the great traditions of the world put the emphasis, they always have the whole, but they put the emphasis very differently. The primordial religions, the aboriginal religions in Australia and in America, they still have them not so distinguished. Word, silence, understanding are still sort of one piece. But when it comes to our Western traditions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, all the emphasis falls on the word. All the emphasis falls on the word. We live by the word. There is a beautiful story from the Jewish tradition about a rabbi, Rabbi Susia. And rabbis are always supposed to quote their teachers and tell what this was my teacher and this is what he said, and sometimes this is what my teacher said who heard it from his teacher, and you have to give the whole pedigree of a good quotation to do honor to all those who have gone before you. And this poor Rabbi Susia couldn't even quote his own teacher because he had never heard what his teacher said, because his teacher was in the habit of reading the scriptures, and as he was unrolling the Torah, he said, "And God spoke," and then he would read. And when Rabbi Susia heard "God spoke," he was already in ecstasy. That was too much for him. And they had to take him out, and he was standing in the hall and in the woodshed, it says, and he was beating his head against the wall saying, "God spoke, God spoke." Imagine what that means, God spoke, you see. And Martin Buber, who tells this story, says that Rabbi Susia knew more than all those who could quote the sermons, because with one word, the word is created. With one word, the world is redeemed. God is too simple. God says just one word, and that's it. To be able to listen to that, to really listen to that, that is the essence of Judaism, Islam, and Christianity. And therefore, the one word that connects these three traditions of the West is the word Amen. I like to, sometimes they are called the religions of the book, sometimes they are called the Abrahamitic traditions. I like to call them the Amen traditions, because it's no coincidence that all three have Amen as a very important word and not translated in any other language. Amen comes from the Hebrew, and Amunah is the faithfulness of God, and Amen is the response to the faithfulness. It is faith itself, it's trust, faith in distinction to beliefs. Beliefs divide us, faith unites us. Faith is trust. You believe something, that's not faith. Faith is having trust in someone, and that faith expresses itself when we say Amen. So this is word, we hear and we respond. That is the Amen traditions. That's typical for them. Now, it's most of us, even when we are not part of any particular tradition of the West, but just the general cultural ambiance, it is very difficult for us to imagine that another tradition, namely the Buddhist tradition, in the Buddhist tradition, the silence plays as important a role as the word plays in the Amen traditions. It's difficult for us to imagine, but the great sermon of the Buddha, the most important sermon of the Buddha, is one in which he speaks no word at all. Now, how can you give a sermon without a word? Well, it says the Buddha held up a flower. It's called the flower sermon. Now, how can you say that you understood the sermon? The moment you say something, you show that you haven't understood. So what happens? One smiles, and the Buddha smiles back, and it says, at this moment, the tradition of Buddhism was handed on from Buddha to his successor. And from then on, ever to this day, it is handed on in silence, because the real tradition is the silence. That is the essence, you see. And when I studied Buddhism, Vladimir mentioned that I studied with Buddhist teachers, and sometimes I thought I had understood something very well, and I would go to my teacher and I would try and memorize just exactly what he said, and I would say, now, did I get this correctly? And he would listen and he would laugh and he would say, absolutely correct, but what a pity that you have to say it. And on other occasions, he would get carried away because we had a one-to-one dialogue, and he was very interested in Christianity. He had come from Japan, and he wanted to learn about Christianity. So he asked me questions, and then he got very eloquent. And in the middle of a sentence, he would break off, and he'd lean back, and he'd laugh with this Buddha belly laugh, and he would say, "Ah, I'm talking again. I have become a Christian." So he understood very well the difference. What word is for the Christian tradition, that is silence for the Buddhist tradition. So a whole world of spirituality that focuses on silence. And it is too good to be true, but there is a third, one of the great traditions that focuses on understanding. Remember that Dr. Singh spoke about yoga as being connected to yoke, and the yoke ties together. It's a yoke of oxen, where two oxen go under a yoke, it ties together. So the same word, yoga and yoke, and that means connecting. And what yoga connects is the word and the silence. And Swami Venkateshwarananda said, yoga is understanding. And Dr. Singh, just to make sure, I asked him once more this morning, I said, what did you exactly mean with this yoga, yoke? And he said, it ties together the unmanifest, the silence, and the manifest, the word. So it's really there. So you have in the one great tradition of the world spiritualities, in this search for meaning, you have these three elements, the word, the silence, and the understanding. And when we go around, I said, restless is our heart, we don't quite know what we are looking for, but when we get a glimpse of it in those peak moments, we will say, this is it, this is it. We didn't even know what we were looking for, but this is it, you see. And this little, this is it, contains the connection between those three traditions. Because the Buddhists, when they have a peak experience, will say, this is it. And the Christians will say, this is it. And the Hindus will say, this is it. And the Jews will say, this is it. Everybody says, this is it. But the emphasis is very different. And the word traditions, or the Amen traditions, will always say, this is it, you see? This is a word of God that speaks to me, these flowers, this is it, and this is it, the water speaks to me, and this is it, the person speaks to me. So we go around and there are these many, many, this is it, and this is it, and this is it, and this is why the words divide us. One says, no, this is it, no, this is it. And then comes the Buddhist, and the silence unites us. And the Buddhist says, look, this is it, and this is it, and this is it. There's the unity between them all. So he unites them all. And then the Hindu comes and says, well, what's really important is that this is it, and this is it, and that's the understanding, and he has tied them all together. So, because this is so, because there is this connection between all of us, all human beings, in our search for meaning, we are all engaged in a big dance, as if we were a big dance where we are all holding hands and celebrating this joy of finding meaning. But imagine now, in your mind's eye, all the world, all the human beings holding hands and having this big, big circle dance, which reflects the circle dance of the Trinity. I mentioned the Cappadocian Fathers called that word coming out of silence and going back through the Holy Spirit into silence, the round dance of the Trinity. Well, on earth, this is mirrored by the circle dance of the religions. Imagine that for a moment. As long as you stand outside of the circle, those who are closest to you will be going in one direction, and those furthest away will go in the opposite direction. And no matter where you stand outside of the circle, they're always walking in opposite directions. And you say, there's no peace, they're all fighting with one another, they're going in opposite directions. The only remedy is that you get in, hold hands, and there's no longer any questions. When you're part of it, you notice that they are going in the same direction. So that is the consequence. That would be the ultimate consequence of the emerging God view, of our shared search for meaning, where we need one another, where we have to help one another in this respect, complement to one another, where we put the emphasis and somebody else puts the emphasis. Only together can we see the whole thing. If we can do that, that would be the best consequence for the future, because then each one of us could put this into practice, we could put it into action, we could act accordingly. You can act, you ask yourself, how do I treat people of other faith? How do I think about them? Am I afraid of them, or am I interested in them, or am I grateful for them because they are putting the emphasis somewhere where I do not put it and where it has to be put? So let's imagine that we are all holding hands and having this big circle dance, and since we can't do it physically, we can do one little thing, and for a few seconds, maybe a minute or so, we can hum together. If we knew a song together, we could sing it, but it's safer to just hum, like a big beehive. You know? When these bees, sometimes they encourage one another when they are a little afraid, and they all hum together. So we can all hum together, and that will be our expression of our unity. So let's do that now. Sieber.